chairman of Shift Gold, located at shiftgold.com, author of several bestsellers, and radio host Peter Schiff. Welcome back.
Well, thanks for welcoming me back.
Great to have you here. And you know, we're watching the U.S. dollar rally. A solid bounce off the lows. We also see inflation, at least according to the Fed's figures, at about 2%. That's the number they watch closely. They're concerned about maybe an overheating economy. What does this mean for precious metals investors?
Well, first of all, I think inflation is headed a lot higher. I mean, at least under the government definition of inflation, of rising prices, I think prices are headed higher, but not because the economy is overheating. I think that prices are going higher because the Fed printed too much money. I mean, that's inflation. The consequence of that is going to be rising prices. And I think we're going to get rising prices despite the fact that the economy is slowing down rather than heating up. In fact, I think the economy is headed back for recession. I do expect us to be in recession maybe even before voters go to the polls this November for the midterm elections. And so that has some big political implications. But I also think rising inflation is bad for the dollar. You know, I think a lot of people think it's good for the dollar because it means the Fed's going to hike rates. But I don't think they're going to keep hiking rates, because I think if the Fed has to choose between helping the economy or fighting inflation, they will help the economy. And they think that, you know, fighting inflation is bad for the economy. I think that inflation is going to run out of control. I think this dollar rally is running out of steam. And I think we're going to resume the decline.
There's been some interesting articles written of the past decade, the Great Depression and the Smoot-Hawley Act. Some people are concerned that this trade war that we're seeing unfold might resemble the outcome, because we saw 66% of global trade decline, according to official figures, in those 3 years of the Smoot-Hawley Act. So do you think we could see something similar?
Yeah, I think what's interesting is so many people are just convinced that America wins the trade war. And by win, they don't necessarily mean that, you know, we do better. It's just that they think that we'll suffer less damage. You know, so the trade war, the prospect of an escalating trade war is really affecting foreign markets to a much greater degree than it has the U.S. market. And it's actually helped the dollar because, again, the perception is the trade war is good for the dollar because it does damage to other economies. But I think this is completely wrong. I think America is the economy that is potentially has the most to lose from a trade war, because America depends on imports more than any other country, in that, you know, we import a tremendous amount of stuff that we don't pay for with exports. And to the extent that tariffs hurt consumers of imported products, which is what they do, the tariffs are paid by the people who buy the products. And so Americans buy more foreign products probably than anybody else. And so Americans are going to be impacted more by tariffs than anybody else. So I think Americans will suffer. I think the American economy will suffer. And what could really be, you know, the bigger blow to the American economy is the backlash if the United States initiating these trade wars causes our trading partners not to want to accumulate as many dollars, not to want to recycle their dollars into U.S. treasuries, then not only could we end up with higher prices for consumers clean their surpluses into our bond market.
Moving on to crude oil, you know, we're looking at the potential for $80 crude oil in the coming weeks and months ahead. Clearly some disruptions in Libya as well as Venezuela. I'd like your thoughts on the potential implications for the U.S. economy and the markets.
Well, crude oil prices, I think, are headed higher. In fact, earlier this morning, we traded above $75 a barrel. That hasn't happened since November of 2014. Now, we're not there now. We actually went back below 73. We're around, you know, we're back in the 73s now, because as the market was on its highs, Saudi Arabia, or there was an Al Jazeera article confirming that Saudi Arabia is going to, you know, take Donald Trump's advice and pump more oil. So we don't know exactly how much more they're going to pump. I mean, Trump tweeted over the weekend about getting the Saudis to commit to 2 million additional barrels a day. I don't know that they have that kind of capacity. And they didn't indicate how much additional oil they would be pumping, but they said they would be pumping more, and that caused the market to drop. But I still think the trend in oil is higher, as the trend is for many commodities. I think this is all part of the inflation that's been in the pipeline. I do expect oil prices to rise above $80 a barrel this year. I think they'll be above $100 a barrel next year. And I think that if you look at how strong the oil market has been in the last month, despite the big rise in the dollar, that shows you how strong oil is, because it means oil priced in other currencies is rising much faster. And normally you see oil prices rising when the dollar falls, not when the dollar rises. So I think when the dollar does turn, and I think it's in the process of topping now, I don't see much upside for the dollar index above 95. And I think there's a lot of resistance there. And as the market starts to break and the dollar index starts to head for new lows, which I expect will happen before the end of the year, at least, you know, new lows for the, you know, these contracts, current contracts, that will really add fuel to the oil bull market.
And of course, the precious metals continue to see consolidation here on the dollar rally. And what are the implications for the precious metals?
Gold probably found the bottom, you know, around the 1250 level. We did get below 1240 briefly yesterday. We're back above 1250. As we're speaking, we're 1256. Gold has recovered all of yesterday's losses and then some. But what's been looking particularly strong to me on this pullback in gold, you know, from the 1300 area down to 1250, has been the strength in the mining stocks. I mean, mining stocks were actually up last week as a group. Even though gold was off $17 last week, the GDX was positive. And there were many stocks on Thursday and Friday of last week that were up 2, 3, 4%. And today, I'm seeing a lot of the names that I own up 3, 4, 5. One of my stocks is up 8% today. So gold stocks are having an extremely strong day today. They were barely down yesterday on the $11 drop in gold, but they are soaring today on the $13 pop. So what I think you're seeing is a good sign that gold has bottomed out. And I've been mentioning this on my podcast recently, that the failure of the stocks to confirm the weakness of the metal is a positive. Just like the last time gold rallied up above 1300, the gold stocks didn't break out. I mean, the gold stocks did not validate the move in gold, and that was a sign that gold's rally was over, and it was good. And if you go back over the last few years, the gold stocks have been a very good, reliable indicator of picking tops and bottoms in the metal. So when you see gold rising and you don't see a big rise in the stocks, the gold investors, gold stock investors are telling you gold's about to pull back. And then conversely, when you see a breakdown in the price of gold, but you don't see selling in the miners, you see buying, then gold stock investors are saying, we think gold has bottomed out and it's likely to go higher. The key is, when is it going to break out? Because obviously, you know, we rally back up to 1300, 1350, there's all the resistance again. So I do think eventually gold is going to break out to the upside. I think the dollar is going to have to be falling for that to happen. And I think the Fed is going to have to back away from its bullish talk about how many rate hikes are coming and how great the economy is. I think if we start to see a more meaningful, reduction in the outlook for U.S. economic growth, and we start to see the markets understand the U.S. economy is not some island of strength in a sea of weakness, that the best growth days are behind us, that growth is decelerating, and I think we're in stagflation. I mean, if you look at all the evidence that's out there, we're not only moving into a weaker economic environment, but a stronger inflationary environment, and a stagflation is the worst possible situation for the Fed. Because, again, the Fed can't handle stagflation. That's why, you know, if you look at the stress tests that the Fed just put the banks through and announced that they all passed, you know, but they all passed the stress test. But the only stress that the bank assumed or that the Fed assumed was the stress of low interest rates and low inflation. Under the worst-case scenario that the Federal Reserve could come up with, the yield on the 10-year Treasury doesn't go any higher than 3%, and the Fed is able to lower interest rates back down to zero, and inflation is, you know, under 2%. That is the worst-case scenario. That is their extremely adverse scenario. The Fed did not bother to see how banks would handle a breakout of inflation or a bout of stagflation. In fact, the Fed assumed in their worst-case scenario, their extreme adverse scenario, was that we go into a recession and the Fed takes interest rates down to zero, but that long-term rates don't fall. They just stay where they are at 3%. And under that scenario, they assume the stock market dropped by 65% and the real estate market dropped by 30% and inflation rose, and unemployment rather, rose to 10%. But inflation stayed below 2%. Imagine what would happen if inflation went to 5 or 6%, if interest rates went to 8%. The Federal Reserve doesn't even want to consider the possibility of stagflation. And I think the reason for that is all the banks that pass these stress tests, if they actually expose them to the stress of stagflation, they would all collapse. I mean, imagine if we go into a recession, and instead of cutting interest rates to fight the recession, they're raising interest rates to fight off the inflation.
Obviously, their real estate component and the mortgage market would implode, and that is a huge source of their revenues.
Think about their long-term, their bonds. You know, the banks have loans, and let's say they've loaned money out, and they're earning 3, 4, 5% on their loans. If the Fed has to jack short-term interest rates up to 7 or 8%.
No, exactly, and we're already seeing some signs of that unraveling in Deutsche Bank in Europe, the largest institution there.
It's worse, too, Chris. It gets worse because what if interest rates really go up during the recession, and now the budget deficits are just absolutely exploding out of control, and the federal government has to raise taxes during the recession in order to make the higher interest payments to our creditors. So imagine a recession where they're tightening monetary policy and tightening fiscal policy in the recession. So instead of stimulating, they're sedating the economy that's already in recession. I mean, so there we're talking massive depression. Now, of course, the only way to avoid doing that is to allow the inflation to run out of control, which is hyperinflation, which, you know, is obviously that's the best possible scenario for gold, and that may be where we're headed.
But can you really outline a scenario where the Fed and policymakers would actually allow that to occur? Hyperinflation is a worst-case scenario, obviously, for the dollar. I mean, it would implode the U.S. dollar.
Remember, in order to prevent that from happening, they have to tighten monetary and fiscal policy into the recession. Real estate prices wouldn't just drop by 30%. They might drop by 60, 70, 80%. Stock prices could drop by 80, 90%. If they were slamming on the brakes in this economy in a recession, in order to prevent hyperinflation, we have to swallow some very, very bitter tasting medicine. That is the problem, because none of the politicians, you think Donald Trump wants the voters to have to swallow that medicine? Told us we had the greatest economy. He's bragging about the stock market. Does he want to take us through something, you know, worse than the Great Depression in order to prevent hyperinflation? Yeah, but the thing is, hyperinflation will end up being worse than that. But the politicians don't know that. But the problem for politicians is they would always trade a crisis in the future for a crisis today. And so they think they're buying themselves time by allowing the inflation to get worse rather than trying to put out the fire. But at some point, you know, it kind of catches up to them and then they lose control of it. And it ends up being much worse than they imagined. But their instincts, the political instinct of every politician is to punt, right, is to try to get this crisis over the next election. We got to get through this next election, and then we'll deal with it.
Exactly. But, you know, we're seeing some prima facie evidence of hyperinflation already. If you look at U.S. equity, sure, we've had a little pullback, but the trend obviously intact. We've had Martin Armstrong and others on here who are calling for maybe another 100% rally, you know, in the weeks and months ahead. Don't you think they would really allow more of a galloping style inflation like late 1970s? And then the end game where they lose control, they let go of the reins of the economy. That's where you see the runaway inflation.
Well, they can't control it like, you know, they're playing a video game. I mean, sometimes they think they can, but ultimately inflation will get out of control, even if they think they've got a handle on it. I mean, they've created so much inflation already over the years with QE1, QE2, QE3. The Fed has some limited supply, I mean, control over the supply of dollars, right? The number of dollars they're creating. But they have no control over the demand for dollars. You know, if people don't want dollars, then there's nothing to do about it. Now, they can try to entice people to hold dollars by raising interest rates. But the problem is, we're so broke, we can't afford to pay the higher interest rates that are necessary to entice people to keep holding dollars. The amount of tax hikes that would be required are basically impossible because you can't get blood from a stone. I mean, the middle class has no money. People are already living paycheck to paycheck and on credit. If you diminish their paychecks with tax hikes, I mean, it's just not, they're not going to be able to survive. There's not enough rich people. Yeah, you can raise taxes on the rich, but that's just going to scratch the surface of what the government's going to need. When you look at how much debt, we have a $21 trillion debt. What if interest rates have to go to 10% to get people to want to hold our currency? We have to pay $2 trillion a year just in interest.
Yeah, servicing that debt becomes impossible. Economic history, of course, rarely repeats. It rhymes. And this time around, we've got 200 million Americans at least, and hundreds of millions of Chinese, and of course Europeans, who don't have $2 to rub together. Okay, so who's going to buy? the precious metals? Will it be the deep pockets, the financial institutions, the pension funds? Who's going to buy it as this unfolds? People don't have any disposable income.
Well, no. I mean, there's plenty of money around the world. I mean, there's plenty of savings, just not net savings in America. But there are individual Americans who have savings. But more importantly, there are people all around the world that have savings. And if their savings are in jeopardy of vanishing to inflation, people will look to preserve the purchasing power of their savings. And the easiest way to do that is by buying gold. And there'll be plenty of demand for gold. But I also think not only will there be demand for gold among individuals looking to protect their savings, but I do think the bigger portfolio managers, the endowments, the pensions, the hedge funds that have no exposure to gold right now, when gold is the only asset rising, they'll be buying it, right? When your stocks are going down and your bonds are going down and you're looking for something that could go up and you see gold and you don't own any, you know, so there's going to be demand there. And I also think that the world's central banks are going to be buying more gold to shore up their balance sheets. I mean, they're going to want to own a reserve that's not somebody else's liability. So I think everybody is going to be buying gold. Right now, nobody's buying gold. But eventually, everybody's going to be buying it. But obviously, when everybody is buying it, the price is going to be a lot higher than now when few people are buying it. I think, you know, just got to watch the economic data for signs that will wake up the populace or the, you know, the conventional wisdom, shake it up a bit, that everything is great in the U.S., that the economy is great, and, you know, that's what's driving the U.S. stock market. It's driving the dollar. Look for weakening economic data. Look for accelerating inflation data to continue to validate the stagflation thesis, which is the one that I have. That is, unfortunately, while, you know, I said it's the worst thesis for the U.S. economy, it's the best thesis if you're a gold investor, because that's an environment in which gold is going to thrive. The last time we really had stagflation was the 1970s, and that was a great decade for gold. I think that we're going to get the 1970s on steroids, so it's going to be even better for gold. If you want to keep following my comments on the gold market and all the foreign markets and the dollar, listen to my podcast, shiftradio.com. You can also check them out on my YouTube channel, Peter Schiff. Go to Europacific Capital, europac.com. Follow me there. Sign up for the weekly digest that, you know, we put out. Read my commentaries and stuff like that, and get some gold from me at Shift Gold. If you don't own any gold, better yet, buy yourself some silver. I mean, the prices there, you know, could really explode. Of course, open up a gold money account. I mean, that's one way to, you know, get a little bit of gold easy that you can carry around in your wallet. You can spend it like anything else.
Great. Happy 4th of July to you and your family.
Yes, and happy Independence Day to you. Bye-bye.